Weekly reasons fabricate, I mentioned that. Aqeedah issues. Fada'il a'mal, fada'il sadaqat. Wallahi, these are not the kutub of Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah. They're not the kutub of Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah. They are Ash'ari Aqeedah. Ash'ari Aqeedah. That's very, very dangerous and very serious issue. If the Aqeedah is bad, don't ask about your Salah and Siyam, because everything else is going to be pretty much bad. The most important thing is our belief system. Is understanding La ilaha illallah. Part of understanding La ilaha illallah is understanding Al Asma'u wa Sifat. In the books that they use, besides the fabricated weak narrations, my Tablighi brothers, you also don't follow the Aqeedah of Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah, which you have to learn from the reliable sources. And then, of course, division and hatred. They are very nice people, but generally speaking, very nice, very kind, unless they see that you may be in opposition, in which case different colors will come. And I've experienced that myself. I was called Wahhabi, Albani, terrorist. I killed innocent people. Why? Because I told them after the salahs that Allah is above the throne. Allah is above the throne. Big fitna in the masjid. Big fitna in the masjid. The kind brothers earlier became enemies. Why? Simply because we differed on issue of aqidah. He read Fada'il Sadaqat. Some boy said that Allah is on his right, Allah on his left, Allah is behind. I said, well, akhi, let me understand this. What do you mean Allah is on his right, Allah on his left? Are you suggesting Allah is everywhere? He said, yes. I said, Allah says, أَأَمِنْتُمْ مَنْ فِي السَّمَاءِ أَنْ يَخْسِفَ بِكُمُ الْأَرْضَ فَإِذَا هِيَ تَمُورِ. He said, huh? Then, khalas, they realized that they're dealing with someone that they will not agree with them. The niceness went away. And then all kinds of names were used and everything. Say, brother, why you do this, man? Why are you dividing the ummah? Leave alone this jama'ah. You want to give da'wah, habibi? Give da'wah 24/7. Give da'wah whenever possible. I'm not telling you don't knock on people's doors and call them to salah. But before salah, call them to Allah. Call them to tawheed. Make sure, if he knew Allah, you think he would leave alone salah?
That's number one. So that idea is an innovation. Secondly, the book Fada'il A'mal, Fada'il Sadaqat, Tabligh Nisab, are not good. They have some good material, but the books are not authentic. I've read them with my own eyes, four eyes. Well, back then I only had two, before I started wearing glasses. The books have bad information. They teach you the wrong aqeedah. They are Ash'ari in their aqeedah, Sufi in their madhab, according to Tariqa, Naqshbandiya, and whatever, the list goes on. So the books which they use are not reliable. Number three, anyone gives a bayan. For 6 years he wasn't praying. They went to his house, gave him da'wah. The first day he comes to the masjid, the second day he's speaking to the people. The Prophet ﷺ said, you don't know, ya akhi, you yourself
liberated either. No? When you totally liberated, then come talk to me, we can discuss. The Quran is created and not the word of Allah. And this is what those of you who know the biography of Imam Ahmad and the fitna and all that, the mihna, this was the argument of the people who are like the Mu'tazila. They're saying that, and see, look, when you hear their argument, it sounds like they're trying to respect Allah. But when you flip it around, it becomes a problem. And that's how he defeated them in many debates. He flipped it around on them. So they said that Allah is qadim, ancient, that he's been there for a long time. And speech is something renewable. So it's not befitting that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, being al-qadim, he has a renewable attribute. And people speak. So how can people speak and Allah speaks? And the ayah says in the Quran, لَيْسَ كَمِثْلِهِ شَيْءٍ. There's nothing like him. So how can people speak and Allah speaks? So they concluded, Allah doesn't speak. So he got them at one point, he flipped it on them. You're saying that because people speak, Allah can't speak. So then he said, do you have knowledge? The man was quiet immediately. Because if you have knowledge, and Allah has knowledge, and nothing is like Allah, that means either you don't, يعني, if you have knowledge, Allah doesn't have knowledge. And actually one of them at some point in the debate, he said, yes, يعني, at some point Allah didn't have knowledge. So Imam tells him, kafart. You've become a disbeliever. So then the guard, there was a guard, just an ignorant person standing. So he got angry. He says, how could you say that to the messenger of Amir al-Mu'mineen? Because he was sent by the Khalifa. So how could you say that to him, that he is not a Muslim? So Imam Ahmad tells this simple guard, he's saying that Allah had no knowledge until he created his knowledge. And how could Allah create his own knowledge without having any knowledge? And he said, the narrator says, the guard then angrily looked at the other guy. How dare you? So he flipped it around on them. Yeah? So, flipping the argument around. Sometimes people tell you Allah is not on His throne. Even until now, Muslims, they'll be amongst us, and they pray with us. They say Allah is not on His throne. Now look how they make it sound respectful. If you say Allah is on His throne, you're physically limiting Allah. See this word? It makes the Muslim guilty. You're physically limiting Allah if you say He's on His throne. Don't physically limit Allah. Where did you get this term from, physically limiting? But they just make you ashamed. Don't say Allah's on His throne. If you say that, you're physically limiting Him. طيب, what's the flip side of that? The flip side is that He's physically everywhere. And these people, until now, they never answer the question, is He in the bathroom? They stay quiet. Is He in the church? They stay quiet. Is He in other places that you wouldn't be caught dead in these places? They're quiet. Is He in the bar? They're quiet. So, if you don't want to say He's on His throne, and by the way, Allah said He's on His throne 6 times in the Quran. He's on Rahman al Arsh istawa. He's on His throne. So if He's not on His throne, then the flip side of your argument is worse. He's everywhere. And that's why many Muslims historically have gone astray concerning this issue. And even wrote poetry saying, وَمَا الْكَلْبُ وَالْخِنْزِيرُ إِلَّا إِلَهُنَا. And the dog and the pig is nothing but our God. How can a Muslim say that? Could you believe a Muslim would say, the dog and the pig is our God? You wouldn't believe that, right? But they did. Why? Because it started off with this concept. Initially trying to respect Allah, but the flip side of it was worse than what they were trying to avoid in the beginning. Because now, the pig takes up space, the dog takes up space, and if God is in everything, then He's inside. Allah is far removed from that. Then He's inside this space. And they said, even the monk in the monastery is our God. One of them, instead of saying Subhanallah, said Subhani, Subhani. Yeah? Because I'm God, God's in me. That's why a lot of these deviant groups, they respect and they treat people very nicely. Why? Not because of akhlaq, because God is in them. They believe that. They believe Allah is in you. So if I hit you, I'm hitting Him. So I have to be nice to you. That's why they're nice to people. So, they got...
And you have to begin with Tawheed. فَلْيَكُنْ أَوَّلْ مَا تَدْعُوهُمْ إِلَيْهِ شَهَادَةُ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ. The first thing you should invite them to is the shahada of La ilaha illallah. They tell you Allah is the creator, Allah is the... We all know that. The kuffar knew that. Where is Tawheed al-Uluhiyya? When their big sheikh, the one who authored some of their books, used to go at the grave site of some of the dead people and wait for wahi and inspiration from dead people. Their big sheikh, I forgot his name now, the one who, Zakaria Idris, Zakaria, something, Elias, the one who invented Jama'at Tabligh, then he used to sit at the grave and cover his head and wait to receive inspiration from a dead man in the grave. This is shirk, yeah.